Welcome to Ring of Fire. I'm Mike Papantonio. Coming up on today's show, we'll tell you why the U.S. court system protected Chevron when they poisoned children in Ecuador. We'll explain how strengthening our labor laws are going to revive our struggling economy. And Sam Cedar, well, he's going to be here to give us all the news that the corporate media refuses to talk about. We have all that and more coming up. And right now, just remember, you've stepped into the Ring of Fire.
You can't change Washington from the inside. You can only change it from the outside.
Grand jury secrecy rules.
For political gain.
The press can find out.
That has nothing to do with politics, but yeah, go ahead.
It wouldn't bother me.
Oops.
Chevron's been poisoning citizens of Ecuador for decades, and a judge in the United States was finally given the chance to do something about it. But instead, he chose to go after the public citizen lawyers who brought the case against Chevron. I have author Greg Palast to talk about this incredibly ugly story. Greg, in weeks past, months past, you've always been telling the stories. Last time we talked to you, you were talking about the BP, the ugly, ugly BP story, where our administration, again, let Wall Street dominate the best interest of the American population. A story that you have followed more than any reporter that I know of, certainly corporate media has not followed this story, is the Chevron story. Lay this story out for us. This is a horrendous, horrendous story. Lay it out for us, would you?
Yes. Chevron purchased Texaco Corporation, which had been drilling in the Amazon rainforest in Ecuador for years. Now, except that they've been, the way they were drilling was all the sludge and poisons and pipes were leaking all over the place. That was a claim made by some local natives. So who cares about local and, you know, the indigenous people of the rainforest? I mean, who's going to listen to them? Well, they got some American lawyers listening to them who filed a suit, and then it got bounced back from the United States down back to Ecuador. Chevron is screaming that it's an entire fraud, that the so-called cancers don't exist among kids, that the oil sludge isn't there. American networks bought the Chevron story hook, line, and sinker. They didn't bother to actually go down to the Amazon and see if the oil's there. So I went up the Amazon. In fact, you'll see me in one of my films in the dugout log to get to a remote native village. And I got to tell you, it was the most ill-making scene I've ever seen. Everywhere there's
okay. Now let me put this in. Let me put this in reference. BBC covered it.
Yes.
Guardian covered it. Every major newspaper in Europe and parts of Asia covered this story, and we couldn't even get the corporate press in the United States to pay attention until this idea came up that, oh, gee whiz, Chevron is now a victim. Poor Chevron, they're a victim of fraud. The same thing we saw with the BP story, the same thing we consistently see with the BP story. So pick up from how bad this toxic garbage, these toxins that were killing children. How bad was it down there? What did you observe?
What I observed was what they're never supposed to do in the U.S. When you bring up oil sludge and the mud and the cement and the crud that is required for drilling, and it pulls up, it should be put in places where it can be safely removed. Instead, it was just allowed to flow into the rainforest, which means it just literally goes through miles and miles of rainforest. Thousands of square miles of rainforest have literally been contaminated in all the water.
Tell us about birth defects. Tell us about how bad the children have been affected, the families have been affected in that area.
Well, to give you an example, I asked the chief of one village, has anyone here been harmed? And he told me his two-year-old son, not knowing that the water was shiny, meaning that there's hydrocarbon, when they have these sheens come out, that his son went swimming, 2 years old, came up vomiting blood, and then died. Now, that's one case, but then I checked with, there's a series of doctors who've been measuring the cancers in the area, and they said it's unbelievable hot spots of childhood leukemia. And I brought this to Chevron, by the way, and Chevron lawyers in Quito, Ecuador just said, what? This is the only case of childhood cancer in the world? You've never seen other no other children ever get cancers? And I showed them the report of the doctors that it was like 1,000 times.
And you showed them the pictures of the waste. Well, showing the pictures, obviously, as we talk about this, people are viewing how bad it is down there. Okay, so down in Ecuador, a court hits them for how many billion dollars just to clean it up?
Right, about $8 billion. Now that's frankly a fraction.
Yeah.
Knowing oil cleanup, I got to tell you, that's a fraction.
Yeah, real projection was around $30 billion.
Yeah, but so they had a hearing. And, and again, a judge looking at all the evidence said, yes, Chevron is responsible, and this is what it's going to cost. This is the payments that must be made to families who lost their children, et cetera. It was a low amount. I mean, it's Ecuador. But Chevron won't pay. And
it was kicked back to the United States to try to enforce the action in the United States. And Judge Kaplan, I think, was the judge on that in New York. We know the history of Kaplan. I've dealt with Kaplan before on pharmaceutical companies. He is absolutely a Wall Street sweetheart. I mean, that relationship is incredible, the closeness of that relationship. But tell us what Kaplan did up here, not to Chevron, but to the lawyers who actually brought the case.
So on top of the kids dying in Ecuador and people getting cancers, I saw people with pustules all over their bodies. You don't want to really see this, but I had to go and report this. In New York, the judge is actually sanctioning the lawyers who brought the case on behalf of these Ecuadorians, people who gave up, in one case, a guy, Steve Donziger. He was a Harvard Law classmate of Barack Obama. But instead of cashing in on Wall Street, this guy took on this case, made it his life's work, almost 2 decades of his life spent on this case, working basically for Zip. And...
Okay,
the judge is telling him he's got to pay Chevron's legal costs for this so-called bogus lawsuit.
Tell me how many times the Judge Kaplan made the trip down there to see the suffering of these people. How many times did he go down there?
As far as I know, dead zero.
Okay, so he makes no trip down there. He starts listening to Chevron, and Chevron starts telling him, Judge, we're a victim here. Here's what these mean old lawyers did. What is Chevron saying?
So Chevron is saying that the case is completely bogus. It's a bunch of, Indians who've been told by a bunch of sharky lawyers that, hey, all you have to do is hit Chevron for damages. No one's going to go down to the Amazon and check and you'll be able to crank Amazon for billions. That's not how it works. That's not what happened. And one thing I want to mention that I would love to show the judge, and I don't know if you ever saw it, the document I have from the Chevron Texaco unit in which the president, I'm not saying a low-level guy, the president of the Texaco unit says, destroy all documents. That's a quote, destroy all documents in the field offices that would suggest or provide the evidence that Texaco Chevron had been dumping the
slug. I guess what's most troubling is you had a court down there with scientists, with experts, with all the information down there in Ecuador that looked at the facts and said, we're going to hit Chevron, you owe us $9 billion just to make a dent in the cleanup. This judge, I'm assuming there was no finding of fact as to the underlying case, right? This in the United States, the only issue was make Chevron pay because this judgment is existing, make Chevron pay. And this judge, from what you know, I don't have any independent knowledge one way or another, but from what you know, never went down there, never conferred with the actual judge who handled the underlying case. Is that correct?
That's correct because, well, again, the judge in New York was just saying the only issue is are these technical matters involving whether the victims can collect in the United States. Because Chevron, you have to understand, played a nice little trick. It owned all these oil fields. It owned all this property. And sold it off. And I went to their offices in Quito and I said, I guess all you have left here that the plaintiffs, the victims can seize are the table and these chairs. They said, we don't even own the chair.
Mm.
They're very smug.
One thing they left is this ridiculous, extensive, ugly pollution for the entire area where families are dying from the exposure, correct?
Yeah, well, now they say, well, that belongs to the government. See, they gave it back to the government. So now it's the government's problem. And the government is, by the way, has accepted I talked to the president of Ecuador. He says some of that oil is, and some of that pollution is ours. We recognize it, but you know, we can test it. The, you know, oil has a chemical tag, like a fingerprint, like every human does. Oil has a tag too. And they know where this stuff came from. They know how old it is. They know it is Chevron Texaco sludge. And the problem is that the victims, the real victims are not, believe it or not, are not the big oil companies here. The real victims are those people out in the Amazon who really have no other water to drink, nowhere to go.
So the judge in the United States, rather than hitting Wall Street's honey, Chevron, this Wall Street-driven judge, as far as I can see history-wise, he says, well, you know what? We're going to go after the lawyers and make the lawyers pay Chevron's costs. Did I get that right? Pay the Chevron's cost and fees for pursuing this case? Is that right?
The judge has hit the volunteer lawyer. I want to emphasize the volunteer legal team for $30 million, the people that represent the natives. And you have to understand, when you go down there and see the tragedy, I mean, these guys, they're all the best lawyers in two continents. And they could have gone off and made a lot of money and spent, instead they spent two decades of their lives.
These are activist, public service activist type lawyers. Is that correct?
That's all they do. They're not in it for the money. They're not getting money. You know, I mean, if you graduated from Harvard Law with Obama, take my word for it, you would be, you can make a lot of money.
What is your take on this judge? Tell me, just give me the naked view that you have of this judge, if you would.
Well, from my own experience in courtrooms, I used to do that litigation work as an expert. This is the type of judge that Americans never see on TV. You know, they were used to those kindly guys who weigh both sides evenly. That's a wonderful fantasy, but that's not how it works. These are political hacks, to put it bluntly. They're political hacks that have been placed on the bench by our corporate betters, and their job is to make sure that Wall Street does not pay. They know that if they start allowing Exxon and Chevron and BP and other companies to be hit in the United States for their foreign filth making, that the Ecuador case will be the first of 50 cases.
What was his demeanor? What was his demeanor towards the activist judge, the activist lawyers that brought this case? What was his demeanor towards them in court?
Well, that's one of the sad things. If you saw films of it, it would be embarrassing. It's not, like I say, it's not Judge Judy even. She would have done a good job, you know, trying to balance the sides and get the information. It ain't Judge Judy. This is all, it's a one-way street. It was hostility from minute one. And the judge, by the way, never actually said that these kids didn't die from Chevron's oil. He kind of skirted that issue and said, well, that case may still be there, but that's not what I'm ruling on. I'm ruling on how bad the U.S. volunteer lawyers are.
Yeah.
So he basically, closed
them down and the case closes down. Greg, I want to continue talking month to month about these stories where corporate America just gets away with just the damnedest things. This is one of them. Greg Palast, thank you for joining me, okay?
You're very welcome, Mike.
Greg Palast's latest book is Billionaires and Ballot Bandits. Working class Americans are struggling to make ends meet while corporate America is seeing record profits. In order to rebuild our economy, we have to strengthen protection for working Americans, and I have Howard Nations with me to tell you how that can be done. Howard, it seems like the media and certainly the Beltway politicians have a very difficult time trying to understand that when labor in the United States flourishes, the economy flourishes, and we actually develop a middle class. We've talked about this so many times, but now we can see we can see the fact that the government's inability or unwillingness to act, both through the Labor Relations Board and OSHA and you name it, we have a government who simply is sitting on their hands, not protecting the American worker. What's your take?
Well, right now, the American public is focused on economic injustice. And it's time to move and try to leverage that concern that the public has. Right now, we're facing a very daunting labor market. And unless there is political intervention by government, federal, state, and local, There are going to be fewer career opportunities. There's going to be loss of economic security. And you're going to have people in America today in the current generation who are going to be making less money than the previous generations. That's unheard of for our society. But the big thing right now is that you're running into a complete failure to implement the rules that are there, to pass new rules, to bring rules up to date. Regulations are completely outmoded. One of the most amazing statistics I've seen on it is OSHA. You take OSHA, for example. Now, OSHA is supposed to be occupational safety and health regulation. But in OSHA, it is amazing to see that they have, in the last decade, they have actually stopped the implementation of more rules and regulations than they have begun, than they have finalized. This is occupational health and safety.
And the reason that seems important is because the last report, I mean, probably the most comprehensive report that came out of the Roosevelt Institute, very important report, talking about how do we make adjustments for the 21st century? How do we avoid trashing the labor market in this country to where it doesn't all just shift over to a third world country? That's what this report was about. They were so concerned that we're losing jobs at a rate that all we're left with in the United States now are service industry kinds of jobs. People working at a hotel, people working in restaurants, people serving wealthy people. That's where this country is headed. And they looked at it, as you pointed out, they said, well, the biggest problem, of course, is the minimum wages are just non-existent in most, they're deplorable. People are working overtime and not getting paid for it. People working in conditions that are so dangerous that day to day they don't know if their life is going to change by an awful injury. There's no labor relationship. You don't have workers that get to negotiate with employers anymore. It's all one-sided. So they took all of these things and they said, right now we are in a very, very serious situation. Pick up from there and say, what do we do to save ourselves to where we don't become a third world banana republic in the labor market?
Well, the anchors of our employment relationship have always been minimum wage, health and safety regulations, and the right to organize. The right to organize, the unions are the cornerstones of the middle class. People who are not members and never been members and would never consider being members have been greatly helped by the union, which lifted everybody. But since the early 80s, these anchors have been decimated. Our laws have been weakened, our standards are stagnated, and the exemptions to regulations are simply bought by corporations through their lobbyists. The employer responsibility has been decimated. They're no longer legally accountable. Employers cut labor costs. They figured out it's cheaper to buy politicians than it is to pay employees. And it's cheaper to buy politicians through the use of their lobbyists than it is to meet labor standards. And OSHA, as you say, has just stagnated. The OSHA regulations, many of them were written in the 70s. They've never been updated. There are incessant attacks on the laws that we have. There's perpetual attempts to change product liability laws to take away the right to recover for things like the latest General Motors fiasco. So there are any number of things that need to be done, but it's all going to have to be policy intervention.
Well, you know what, Howard, and I'm not embracing this position, but you're seeing more and more writers that have been great populists. They've been great progressives. They've been advocates in every sense of the word. They've been journalists. They've been media folks that have said, you know, I'm damn tired of trying to save the middle class when the middle class brought this on themselves. If you look at and here's, again, this is not me speaking. This is coming from all different directions. It is that, you know, it's the middle. It's a big part of these workers that they were so ginned up on cultural issues like guns and gay rights and racial issues that they said they ignored the fact that corporate America and beltway politicians We're taking away their jobs. We're making it to where they don't get minimum wages when they work overtime. They don't get any wages when they work overtime. There is no fight. There's no balance between employer and employees. There's no regulations to protect them on the job site. There's nothing to protect corporations for shipping jobs overseas and getting tax benefits to do it. That's where this is all headed. So you have a whole group of people, Howard, that are saying, you know what, hell with them. This is what they wanted. This is what they brought on themselves. They got so ginned up on cultural issues, this happened to them. I hate to see that happening, but you would have to agree that is happening within the progressive media right now, isn't it?
It's definitely happening. And those people that are so concerned about their guns, a lot of them right now are being the victims of wage theft by employers. Wage theft is a fairly new term, but it's come about as a result of people who are not paid the minimum wage that are entitled to it under law, people who are denied overtime pay, people who are working in hazardous workplaces, people who have retaliation for speaking up. All those things that unions protect this middle class from, they don't have those anymore, and wage theft has become a huge, huge, huge problem. There was a recent study called Broken Laws and Unprotected Workers, where they looked at 4,000 low-wage employees in New York, Chicago, and Los Angeles. 26% were getting less than a minimum wage. 78% were underpaid for their overtime. 70% received no pay for coming to work early or for working late. And 43% had illegal retaliation in the event that they complained about it. The people that were targeted were not just immigrants, but they were women and people of color. But all workers, according to this study, all workers are at risk for wage theft by employers.
Okay, and so what we see now happening in the Beltway is you have people like Paul Ryan, for example, are saying, gee, let's go ahead and give corporate America an actual tax break for taking their corporation, moving it out of the United States, moving it to Saipan, moving it to India. Let's give them a tax break to do that. And you still have these same people, the same boneheads that, as I say, it's collectively the progressive media. They're saying, I'm tired of it. I'm tired of trying to fight for these folks. I'm just at the point of giving up. These same people are paying more attention to things like gun rights and gender rights than they are the fact that as their tensions over there, corporate America is taking their jobs over here, out of the country. And we're becoming a service industry. There's no way around it. We don't build things anymore. We don't make things. We don't even fix our own damn roads. We've become a banana republic service industry, haven't we?
We really have. And the thing that's being really wasted, Mike, is the incredible leverage that government could have in correcting these problems. The purchasing power of the United States government is $1 trillion a year they spend. It's $500 million a year in purchases. It's a half trillion a year in purchases. A half trillion a year of money going to the states. And then an additional $50 billion a year that money is being distributed by the states. If they would simply tie the enforcement of existing laws and regulations and the passage of new regulations to that money, to getting those contracts, to getting those infrastructure contracts and things of that nature, incredible things could be accomplished. But the Beltway is more concerned with money going to the politicians. It carries more weight. The result is they can't pass legislation. They won't pass regulations. They won't enforce existing laws and regulations.
And all they have to do is something as simple, Howard, as you're pointing out. They have $500 billion to play with. They could say, you know what, Mr. Employer, you just lost your government contract. You know what, Mr. Employer, you just lost your subsidy. You know what, Mr. Employer, you on a competitive bid, you're not taking care of your workers, and we can't do business with you. They could do all of that, but again, you have an administration that talk big. Oh, my God, they were going to do so much for the worker. Yeah. They were going to make the worker's life better. And an administration who talks a big game, but at the end of the day, they've done nothing for the American worker. And I'll point out, the American worker has done nothing for themselves either. Howard Nations, thanks for joining me, okay?
My pleasure, Mike. Thanks.
Paul Ryan's recent budget proved once again that we have a Republican Party that could not care less about the average American. It's all about how much money can we give to corporations, how much money can we give to billionaires, and to hell with everybody else. I have Seth Katz here to talk to me about that very topic. Seth, the big-hearted Republicans at it again, trying to take care of American consumers. My God, how could the Paul Ryan budget proposal, the Republican budget proposal, get any uglier?
You know, it really can't. If there's a program that's good for America, good for America's future, they're wiping it out in favor of tax cuts for the rich, for corporations, and the super, super wealthy in this country, Pap, at the expense of the populace.
Well, let me just get this right. Now, you have a budget here that the Republicans are trying to sell this as a budget that's going to help rebuild America. That's their talking point. This is going to rebuild America. What they're going to do is they're going to cut low-income home energy assistance. They're going to cut Medicaid. Go through the list. It's amazing what they want to cut. And then they want to give to the military three times what the military is actually asking for. What, $400-something billion?
I mean, something along those lines. It's really the anti-Robin Hood, Pap. They're at the point where they're going to make the American dream impossible. They're going to make education more expensive and out of reach for the masses. They're going to kill Pell Grants. Education is something that this country was built on, giving everybody the opportunity to better themselves, to pull them up by their bootstraps. But what this budget will effectively do, at least on that front, is prevent the middle class from getting an education and ever having a hope to get to the Republican class that they're trying to create.
Okay, so education. Let's look at this. You go through this and you go, if it benefits corporate America, if it benefits billionaires, they've built it into their budget. For example, one thing that they're doing is they're actually going to give tax benefits to a corporation that sends jobs overseas. In other words, a corporation is going to say, I don't want to build my plant here. I want to go overseas. And the Republicans say, well, that's good, Joe. You do that, and we're going to give you a tax benefit. That's just the beginning of it, though. And talk about what they want to do to Medicare, what they want to do to virtually every safety net program in this country.
You know, Medicare, they're going to turn into a voucher program. The problem is going to be, ultimately, the cost of medical care is going to outgrow and outpace the increases that are going to be available to fund Medicare. Medicaid, the states are going to be limited in what they can do. You know, they cry that this is not a voucher program. They're going to try to repeal Obamacare, which is another completely unrealistic thing that'll put 13 million Americans without health care. And people are still going to get sick. They can't, they can't use their tax cuts for the wealthy to prevent the poor from getting sick. And it's going to all come home to roost. And it's kind of like what they did when George W. Bush got elected twice. They are trying to convince America to vote for policies that are not in their best interest, but are only in the best interest of the richest of the rich and the corporations. I mean, they're not going to close any of the loopholes in the tax code for the corporations. You know, in doing my research and looking at it, the Obama budget is going to close loopholes that will raise $651 billion. The Ryan budget only is going to raise $153 billion by closing a very limited number of loopholes.
Okay, here's where this really turns, doesn't it? The Republicans know that you're going to have this Obama administration cave in on virtually almost everything, except Obamacare. They won't cave in on Obamacare, but they'll cave in on giving the military almost $500 billion increase that they're going to give to the military, when the military is saying, we don't even need that much money. they're going to cave in on the idea of, you know, you've got these folks saying, let's only tax the billionaires 25% and let's tax the multi-billionaire corporations only 25%, and then let's give them a bonus if they'll take jobs offshore. Now, what's the Obama administration going to do? Cave. Don't you see that this is the way this is being set up? Because they're dealing with a cave administration that caves on everything except Obamacare.
Right. I think you're right. You couldn't be more right. And how do they say they're going to balance the budget? By cutting almost $800 billion from the services that this country gives to people in need, to get them back on their feet, to educate their children, to make sure that they have heat in the winter, to make sure that they have food on their plates. You know, they're going to cut food stamps. You know, and there's 70% of the people in this country think that those programs are valuable to the future.
Seth, isn't part of the problem, real quickly, isn't part of the problem that if you put this money, whether it's food stamps, whether it's Medicare, if you put money at the bottom, it helps the economy because the money moves up. When you give more billions to corporations and billionaires, the money never moves down. So this is an economic analysis. This isn't just a morality analysis. This is a pure economic analysis that the Republicans simply can't get through their head because they're getting so much money from the billionaires, so much money from the corporations. And unfortunately, it's not just the Republicans nowadays. The Wall Street owns both of these parties, and we're going to get something really ugly come out of this budget negotiation. That's what it's looking like to me.
It's sad but true, Mike. You're right. You know, the Ryan budget or the GOP budget also cuts the budget for the Securities and Exchange Commission, which is de facto deregulation. It's going to cause another collapse in the economy because there won't be enough regulators to oversee the fraud that's going to occur once they all get thinned out.
Nobody looking over their shoulders on Wall Street. This is perfect for Wall Street. It's horrible for the American consumer. Thank you for joining me.
Have a good day, Pat.
Most people think that the cozy relationship between Wall Street and the White House is a fairly new phenomenon in America, but the truth is that bankers have held considerable power almost over every president for the last 100 years. Joining me now to talk about how this happens is Nomi Prins, author of the new book, All the President's Bankers. Nomi, you know, until you understand the history of bankers in the United States and the relationship that they have with presidents, it's hard to understand what happened to us in this last big scam, this last big burn down. Your new book, without a doubt, All the President's Bankers, is just, it nails it because what it does is it puts things in context. I love your discussion when you talk about the Penn Sea fairy tale, the Penn Central fairy tale. And that I think I'd like to start the discussion with that. That is 1970 when we first started seeing the, at least my adult history, when we first started seeing the relationship between government and the banks. Lay that out for us a little bit.
Yeah, the interesting thing about all of the times in the 70s was the relationships, the very close personal family social connections between people who ran the White House, the people who ran the biggest Wall Street banks were well established through, and I trace them back through the panic in 1907 with Teddy Roosevelt's relationship with J.P. Morgan, and I go forward. And by the time we get to the 70s, though, something happens. And yes, that Penn Central merger and the Penn Central fairy tale, as you mentioned, became America's biggest bankruptcy at the time in the 70s. And the response, because so many bankers were involved in this, and it was this convoluted entity, Penn Central. It was a conglomerate of all sorts of different types of tentacles. It was reminiscent of what had happened into the crash of 1929, where companies, utility companies, and banking companies, and finance companies, and insurance were all sort of doing little farms of different pieces of business all under a similar umbrella, and there was regulation put in place to avoid doing that, and that regulation was kind of broken down over the years. And by the time you got to Penn Central, which was something that President Johnson had been very much behind before he was president, and then it sort of fell apart, All of a sudden, the bankers that were involved needed, wanted, got federal support. And it came in through a military back door at the time, which was that basically it was important for national security to support. That was the reasoning at the time.
Yeah.
The bailing out of this conglomerate, because it had been funded by some of the biggest banks at the time, including National Citibank at the time, which is now a Citigroup, was a proponent in trying to get the government to bail this thing out. And that was really the earliest instance.
Well, it was the too big to fail, and I think the way that you characterize the argument is the national security grounds. You know, gee whiz, we can't let this happen. Of course, we heard that if you listen carefully with the last burn down, mm-hmm. where national security requires that we give these incompetent, greedy, thuggish, boob bankers on Wall Street another bailout, is because it has to do with world accountability, the balance of powers in the country. And you start your book again. By the way, as Nomi Prins always does, great quality. And you start the book talking about how we've seen this. You talk about the fact in 49, or right after the Second World War, we started seeing the expansion of banks, where we would take, for example, the David Rockefeller types would take. Try to capture revenue and make these kind of ridiculous interest loans to places like Latin America and mm-hmm. emerging countries. And then when things started going wrong, we said, oh, we have to save these folks from themselves because it's a national security interest. Isn't that the first time we started seeing that before we started really making inroads to the Glass-Steagall protections?
Yeah, there was a situation after World War Two or three things happened. One is that the World Bank and IMF were established, and they were established in such a way that they were going to fund, you know, supposedly they were these international entities, but really they were very much dictated by American political interests, you know, from Harry Truman and forward, and also a man named John McCloy, who became the chairman of Chase after he was appointed the second president of the World Bank. And the important thing about his appointment was he made the World Bank into a vessel for private investment in private bonds. He said, I won't become president of the World Bank. I won't accept the presidency of the World Bank unless Wall Street is allowed to be the distribution mechanism for bonds. And what that enabled Wall Street to start to do was to tie the financial interest of the banks to expand into other countries with the political interest of the United States to expand their sort of dominance over these other countries as well after the Cold War. And Latin America was certainly a place where a lot of that was done. And then sort of after that, in the 50s, under Eisenhower, his whole Eisenhower doctrine was this idea of promoting really capitalism over communism and using military might of the United States to support countries into which bankers opened branches. And so there was this alliance of the powers of what Eisenhower wanted to do and what the big bankers wanted to do at that time, to expand into these countries with military, economic, trade, and financial elements.
Yeah, the thing I think we've talked about this before. Capitalism requires debt, doesn't it? In other words, you have to bring money into the system, but at some point there's always that debt element that's required in capitalism to maintain capitalism. And so it seems to me that as I'm reading what you've written here, you had international banks that started emerging, where at one point we had America kind of had, you know, we kind of had the market on everything. We could go South America, we could go to Asia, we could do what we wanted to do without much competition. And then along comes this international competition once they get their legs up underneath them after World War II. And we start saying, oh, my God, we got to do something. And
now what do we do?
Yeah, and this is also, it was a nationalism argument. It was also this national security kind of argument that we have to abandon regulations. The way I read this, did I get that right? Or
No, that's precisely right. Because after the 50s, where there's this military and financial alignment to expand and to overtake what was now emerging in Europe and Japan as banks, kind of, you know, post-war, American banks wanted less competition. And, of course, American generals politically wanted to expand more. So that was going on at the same time. And then by the time we got to 60s, yes, there was a lot of more opening into Latin America and other places. It really took off in the 70s when the the banking community, particularly Rockefeller and Rishton, were hiking, John McClure, were hiking through the Middle East to be able to take oil money and convert it into debt for the third world. And capitalism, profitable capitalism to the people that control it, requires, yes, it requires, you know, dumping debt into countries that can't afford it so that you can take the commodities or the raw materials or the you know, individual national economic health and convert it into profit. And that is what happened. So throughout the 60s and part of the 70s, and the books were very bad at the time for these banks, so they're expanding internationally, and you really couldn't even tell. You know, there's not the same kind of technology even, and now things are hidden as well in a sort of different way. But then it was very easy to hide numbers as well.
In other words, you can...
A lot of possibility was coming from the third world.
Yeah, you can say to Guatemala, look, we're going to give you, or let's say South Africa, we're going to give you this money. We really know you can't pay it back. I mean, the terms are ridiculous. The terms are
right.
We're going to control the terms, but we would like your zinc. You know, we can't get this back in money. But in order for capitalism to work, that debt has to trigger more influx of value, and that value may be diamonds. It may be zinc. It may be copper. And that,
and we'll extract it.
Yeah. So that expansionism is really what we're counting on. The first time I think we really saw maybe too big to fail was when we started seeing these worldwide loans of, say, Chase. And, you know, before we know it, Bank of America had surged in value to 27 billion, maybe almost 30 billion, doubled, you know, almost doubling every 5 years. And so that's where we got this notion of too big to fail, if I read this right. But I think one thing that's interesting to me is I think people miss the argument that when we had to give all these incompetent boobs on Wall Street money because they stole money and they had Ponzi schemes of every kind working, when we had to do that, we actually heard our government, our president, our administration saying, well, this is all about national security. You know, this we have to do this, and
yeah.
Now too big to fail is here forever. Give us some examples of how we've given the free pass to just not. I don't think it's just greed. I think it's just sheer incompetence sometimes to the, you know, the Goldman Sachs types, the Bank of America types. Seems like we've given them a free pass ever since the burn down, haven't we?
Well, yeah, the argument of national security is very big in the Cold War, in the beginnings of the Cold War. And then in the 70s, as I mentioned before, things shifted into bankers sort of dissecting from even aligning or feeling the need of the alignment with the government, though the close, tight relationships on a social basis were still there. They were more perfunctory than sort of personal. And as we started to get away from that, the argument sort of morphed from national security to American competitiveness. And that's when things really started going off kilter, because the idea of deregulating the American banks was promoted by a succession of bank leaders, particularly at the top of National City, of Citibank and of Chase and so forth from the early 80s with the Reagan administration and the first George Bush, who had a task force within that administration that was dedicated to deregulating the banking system. And the argument that was used from Don Regan, the first Treasury Secretary of Ronald Reagan, through Nicholas Brady, who was the Treasury Secretary under George Bush first, was that American competitiveness was at stake. And if American banks, particularly the biggest banks, no one cared about the little farm banks and the credit. You don't care
mom
about
and pop big, doesn't matter here, yeah.
No one cared about those. Those are failing through all these rooms of us, so no one cared. But the ones with, because the political financial alignment is what really drove and mutually reinforced. I talk a lot about this mutual reinforcement in the book. There was a social context and there was a political financial reinforcement of power from both poles, from the White House to Wall Street. And so when the argument became American competitiveness, this was very big post-Cold War in Washington. And the exact words, and I looked at all the documents when I went to these archives around the country, but literally some of the same words that Treasury Secretary Nicholas Brady used under Bush and that Robert Rubin later used under Clinton to continue to deregulate the banking system in the United States were regarding American competitiveness. There were two things going on. One was they said, well, banks are expanding anyway, we can't be in their way. And the reason we can't be in their way is because America can't afford to lose their edge, their
right.
competitive edge in the world. So
right.
the competitive edge went from a military Cold War edge to augmenting that with a financial edge. And at that point, that's when things went really off kilter. Things were getting, the reforms were not coming. There was no counterbalance to what was happening with these arguments. There's no counterbalance to the meetings that were happening between these bankers and in Wall Street. And in fact, there was an act that was passed in 1994 was signed by Clinton to deregulate from the state lines in terms of banking to allow them to consolidate their deposits more.
Let me back up just a little bit. You, one thing that you said here is that there's always, it's kind of a follow the money analysis. I mean, I'd like to say that if we look at the top 20 Obama contributors for his, for his career political campaigns, I mean, we know who they are, Goldman and J.P. Morgan. Okay, so here we have the money always flows to the top from the very first story you tell in this book, if you really follow the money. Here we've got a president who has sat back. He's allowed Goldman Sachs to pay $550 million fine for criminal activity. Nobody goes to jail. Bank of America, I think, pays $150, never admits any guilt. J.P. Morgan Chase, $1 billion. Nobody goes to jail. No perp walk. Citigroup, $500 million, no perp walk. But if you look at the history all the way back to the time that we first started seeing these developments of, of too big to fail in one form or another, whether it was Lockheed or whether it was Penn Central or whether it was, whether it was Rockefeller Bank in South America, it was always not just, the talking point seemed to be nationalism, national security, but it was really about money, wasn't it? I mean, if you really follow
it was it. Absolutely. It was about money, and that's where this connectivity. That's where it's not just about bankers sort of running Washington like it gets spoken about. It was a complete collaboration, a symbiotic interdependence between Washington and Wall Street, because money was power to both. Expansion was a way to get more money to both. And the influence that came with that ultimately allowed both to be more powerful in their separate realms. I mean, they always were, but they mutually reinforced each other. And the arguments just sort of changed verbally depending on what was going on in the world at the time. So it's national security, it's American competitiveness. Now maybe with what's going on in the Ukraine, if things escalate much further, it might be national security again. But the fact is that there was this lockstep both relationship and political financial alliance between the major bankers, the ones that were in for decades in their positions. Like, we don't elect these people. We elect the presidents. But what happens is a lot of these bankers, the really big names, were John McCloy, Winthrop Aldrich in the 30s, David Rockefeller throughout the 70s and early 80s, Tom Clausen, who went back and forth from Bank of America to head of the World Bank to Bank of America during the Third World Debt Crisis. All these people stayed in their positions running these major pools of money, these major financial institutions, which have our deposits for decades,
and the money
but then the
part of this that I think is so obvious, but you've done such a good job tracing it, is how is it that an Obama says, listen, I'm going to let all this go. I'm just going to tell Eric Holder. Do you remember Obama coming out and saying, we have to look ahead? Well, that was a nice way of saying, I don't want to prosecute anybody because these people have given me so much money. John Corzine, isn't that a great example? MF Global. Yeah. Now, this MF Global, $6 billion abyss that he created. He knew exactly what he was doing. There was
absolutely
no, this was not just bad investment. I think in your book you talk about Corzine was strategizing how they could use customer funds to avoid this burn down. And I mean, it's right there. It's fraud. It's very evident. But nevertheless, this administration takes a pass on it. Corzine isn't prosecuted. Why? Follow the money all the way to the top of the administration. And that's always been the case. It was the case with Nixon, with Penn Central, if you take a look at that. So, I mean, there's no way to change this as far as I see. I don't know how, once Glass-Steagall went out the door and we started saying, well, hell, I mean, banks can now engage in commodity trading. They can store up commodities. We kind of lost the fight, I think, Nomi. Maybe, I hope I'm wrong, but maybe not.
No, ironically, commodity trading, copper trading was what caused the first panic in 1907, bad copper trading that created this whole era of financial capitalism and this both the expansion of a social connection, which I go through with bankers and presidents, right, to a political financial policy connection and an impact on the rest of us connection. So, yeah, the reward for bad bets and bad behavior is to increase the capital with which you can do that bad behavior with. The big banks are bigger than they were before the 2008 crisis. They have more capital. They have more concentrated derivative influence and everything else. And absolutely, the Obama administration, and it will be any administration.
Yeah,
right now.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. It's not just Clinton.
It just so happens. And I'm not saying Obama has been deeply weak on this whole thing. There is no doubt. Obama has a lot of people in his cabinet that were members of the Clinton cabinet, as we talked about before, that have been fine with this idea of competitiveness and lack of regulation. And you have the press. You have a lot of people in the press saying, well, the Glass-Steagall disintegration was not what caused the recent meltdown. And yes, it was. The minute you give banks capital, whether that is insured deposits, whether that's additional leverage to what they have, whether that's the idea that they will be bailed out, whether it's with exact cash that's or buying of shares that agreed upon by Congress, or whether that's $4.2 trillion of debt that the Fed is holding on their behalf so they have liquidity or capital to do other things. Whenever they have no accountability, no restraints, no reform, that is when you have further crises. And you have the political financial alliance on both sides, in Washington, on Wall Street, that pushes this whole situation forward. There's no demand. FDR demanded something from the bankers, and some of the bankers at that time, it's an interesting section in my book, actually allied with FDR to create Glass-Steagall because they believed it would be in their best interest.
Yeah, they realized
we don't
problem.
Have that even.
Right.
They exactly.
Nomi Prins, as usual, great, great book. We'll be promoting this book left and right. Thank you for writing it, okay? It's such an important book. Thank you for joining me.
Thank you, Mike.
So, Pap, there was a big report put out by Politico, and this is not going to come, I think, as a huge surprise, at least in general, to our audience. I mean, we've been saying this for years. We've been pointing it out that on the right, there is this huge, dole system, if you will, where we have talked about this quite a bit, but now we see sort of the specific contours.
Well, let's put it in perspective. They went back, and these researchers went back, and they looked at IRS they went disclosures, and they found out that, for example, it's $22 million that organizations like Right Wing Heritage Foundation, Tea Party Foundations, every right wing in the world is simply buying the voice of people like Rush Limbaugh and Hannity. They're actually paying them to say specific things. The one thing this story doesn't talk enough about that I've seen written other places, they actually write the talking points for Rush Limbaugh.
Oh, sure.
They write the talking points for Hannity and say, deliver this on the air.
And frankly, for those guys, it's a service that they're getting. They're just getting paid. Not only are they getting the service, they're not paying for the service, they're getting paid to use the service.
Yeah.
And, we've been talking about this for a long time, that the right wing is just simply vastly overfunded relative to the left, and that they have subsidized these programs. I mean, make no mistake about it, this isn't just a question of these groups going out there and saying, this is going to be an opportunity for us to reach a broader audience. They are subsidizing their agenda through these right-wing talkers. There's nothing illicit about it, but people should understand, we kept being told over and over again, this is we are winning out in the free market. Well, they're winning out in the free market because, frankly, they're subsidized by billionaires who want them to carry their water for
them. Let's be clear. Okay, NRA, for example, or some anti-immigration organization or some anti-minority organization, somebody like Storefront, they're just dressed up, Stormfront, like we just talked about, they're just dressed up differently. They have a name like maybe the Heritage Foundation. It sounds like it's real intellectual. Well, what they'll do is they'll write this out, and then they'll say to Glenn Beck, Glenn, here's what you have to say. Say these things, and we're going to pay you $3 million to do that. Rush, we're going to pay you $9 million. Here's what you must say. Go on the air and make it sound like you're reporting. Make it sound like you've actually looked at this and analyzed it. Don't disclose that we're paying you just like we would a puppet to say exactly what we want you to say.
Well, you know, I don't know. I mean, I frankly am not convinced that these guys wouldn't be saying more or less the same thing without this backing. But I think the bottom line is they wouldn't have the opportunity to. I mean, they would not, their business models would not be sustained and would not have grown and would not and could not continue but for these massive slush funds that they're getting the money for. And so, like I say, these guys might go out there and espouse the same ideas, but they have basically a team of writers who are writing it for them, and that's a benefit for them right there. But they could not exist but for amount of money that flows from the Koch brothers and from the
advertisers wouldn't look. What sane advertiser? I mean, honest to God. What sane advertiser stays with Rush Limbaugh after he just absolutely vilifies minorities, says basically they're useless in so many words, vilifies women, makes them look like they're just for nothing other than having babies and run around barefoot? This is what this guy talks about every day. These are the kinds of things he talks about. So what sane advertiser says, you know, I really like that. I'm going to stick with him. Maybe somebody will buy my car if they hear Rush talk like that. But the point is, Rush doesn't care because he's been paid under the table, you see, by these right-wing nut job organizations that have a lot of money.
That's right. And you know, the most recent there was a most recent report that came out that basically said that Rush is tanking in Los Angeles and in New York. In major cities across the country, and yet, of course, he's still getting paid millions of dollars.
He doesn't care because he gets paid under. Yeah, he gets paid
Indeed.
Under the table. And well, I mean, Sam, listen. I mean, let's foolishly. We have had people come to us asking for similar kinds of things, and we've said no. I mean, you know, who in this business hasn't? But we, you know, when we deliver a story, it is because we believe the story, not because some numbnut has said, "Listen, this is what you must say. Here it is." Read it, and they're like talking parrots. That's what you have with Hannity. That's what you have with Rush. That's what you have with Laura Ingraham. That's what you've got with virtually every right-wing talker out there. There's just no other way to avoid it. That's it for this week's Ring of Fire, but you can keep up with us throughout the week online at ringoffireradio.com or on Twitter at Ring of Fire Radio and on Facebook. I'm Mike Papantonio. We'll see you next week right here on Ring of Fire.